On the economic front, Canada tends to be about 10 years behind the US in technology and business growth. However, in social policy, it's actually the opposite. Canada tends to lead the US. Gun policy has been a hot topic in both countries, and on Friday, Canada made a big change which may make its way to the US in the future. On Friday, Canada's Prime Minister Justin Trudeau announced that he has banned the sale and transfer of all handguns in Canada. He announced Friday that when people are being killed and people are being hurt, responsible leadership requires us to act. But does Canada actually have a handgun problem? The Think Report is impartial to any political party, and I personally don't own any handguns, which puts us in the right spot to dig into whether or not Canada has a handgun problem, and if banning them will help. I'm Kris, and this is the Think Report. There's much to cover on this topic, and I was originally going to talk about a few things in this episode, but instead we went deep on the topic of handgun ownership in Canada and found some pretty interesting stuff. Does Canada actually have a handgun problem? Trudeau claims that gun violence is getting worse in Canada. So, naturally, our first step was to validate that claim. The chart below is from Stats Can and illustrates the total amount of violent crime versus the amount of violent crime involving a firearm. As you can see, the claim that violent crime involving firearms is on the rise is true. However, it's also true that violent crime not involving a firearm is on the rise. That's really important to note, and we'll come back to that a bit later. The next thing to determine is how big the problem is. We needed to compare Canada's violence against the violence in other nations. Using data from healthdata.org, we were able to view deaths by firearm. Since countries have different population sizes, per capita is the data we need to look at. There aren't many surprises when we look at the top countries. The top five countries are Venezuela and El Salvador with 37 deaths per 100,000, which is a lot. Guatemala at 33, Colombia at 25, and the U.S. Virgin Islands at 23 deaths per 100,000. The U.S. is number 22 on the list, at 11 deaths per 100,000, below Uruguay and St. Lucia, and above Panama and Iraq. That's not the worst, but that's also not very good. To be worse than Iraq in gun deaths is pretty bad, considering the U.S. tore that country to shreds 20 years ago with the Iraq War. Canada ranks 85 on the list, with 2 deaths per 100,000. 2.28 to be exact, since when you get that low on the list, the decimal points start to matter since you're dealing with such small numbers. So to recap, is gun violence getting worse? Yes. Is it a problem? I mean, it doesn't appear that way when you compare Canada to other countries. The US is 11 times worse per capita. But maybe gun violence makes up a large portion of total violence in Canada. Turns out, that's also no. The graph below illustrates the amount of firearm-related crime as a percent of all violent crime. As you can see, gun violence is a small portion of all violence, which is 3% nationally, with Regina being the highest at 5.5% of all violent crime. Logically, we wanted to know why this varies by region. Although it's not clear, there does seem to be an overall problem with violence in northern communities. These are communities where the federal government is the police force. This is the way law enforcement works in Canada. If there is no police force, Canada must provide law enforcement, you know, social contract and all. So the Royal Canadian Mounted Police will be the law enforcement in rural areas where the province doesn't have the budget or the population to enforce it themselves. Where the province does have the budget, they will enforce it with provincial police, like the Ontario Provincial Police or the BC Provincial Police. And where the municipality or the city has the budget to police it themselves, they do, with law enforcement like Toronto Regional Police or Calgary Police Service. When we look at the same data broken out by the province over a 10-year period, we see that the increase in gun violence largely occurs in less populated provinces, like Manitoba, Saskatchewan, Yukon, and the Northwest Territories, with the Northwest Territories being the worst with almost a 100% increase in gun violence. Again, areas where the RCMP is law enforcement, which is something that Trudeau specifically has influence over because the RCMP is a federal organization. So what happened that made gun violence grow? Let's take a look at trends in violent crime again. As you can see, there is a large spike in gun violence in 2015. In fact, gun violence was trending downward from 2009 to 2014. So what happened in 2015? Well, Justin Trudeau was elected and law enforcement budgets were cut. To be fair, though, law enforcement budgets were cut 2 years prior in Stephen Harper's government. However, Trudeau hasn't returned them to their previous levels. Digging deeper, below we graphed the number of police in Canada per capita. As you can see, there is a clear drop in the number of police officers per capita. In fact, the last 10 years represent a 10% drop in the number of law enforcement officers per capita. 10%. So wait a minute. Gun violence has increased during the same time that law enforcement funding has been cut? Has no one considered that a 10% decrease in police presence in law enforcement programs would result in a significant increase in gun violence? Gun control laws haven't changed over the past 10 years. In fact, they've been basically the same since 1976 when the government prohibited automatic guns, and in 1979 when the government required that everyone have a gun license to own a gun. Therefore, it's not Canada's gun laws that are causing the increase in gun violence. There's another thing that changed in 2015. The graph below is the number of immigrants welcomed into Canada. After a period of slow growth, we see an increase starting in 2015. Don't misunderstand this graph. We're simply pointing out possible causes of an increase in gun violence by searching for things that changed during the period of 2014 and 2015. Canada and the US absolutely need immigration to maintain their economies, which I explained in my last immigration video. But what this does illustrate is that there's likely multiple factors that are contributing to an increase in violence, but Canada's gun laws don't appear to be one of them, since obviously they didn't change. So this begs the question, what on earth is the Prime Minister doing? I can tell you what he's not doing. He's not looking at the actual data, or maybe he's conflating US news and Canadian news. This is a real possibility. About a year ago, I had a chance to speak with Jesse Brown, the host of the Canada Land podcast, and he mentioned to me that often Canadians prefer to hear about US news over Canadian news. Perhaps Justin Trudeau is just conflating gun violence messaging between the US and Canada. All right, so back to last Friday when Trudeau froze the sale of handguns in Canada. Personally, I think he's pissed a lot of people off, and I doubt that this will be a lasting law. But in the meantime, we have an example that we can look at from when a country did ban the sale and transfer of handguns. In 1996, at Dunblane Primary School in the UK, Thomas Hamilton shot and killed 16 students and a teacher before killing himself. To this day, it's still the deadliest mass shooting in UK history. After the mass shooting, politicians banned handgun ownership in the UK, with the exception of Ireland. Advocates for the law boast that... Hold on a sec. Before publishing this video, I actually found some really interesting information. So consider this an addendum to the video. The first is from the Fraser Institute, which sources data from the FBI. And the second is from the Office for National Statistics in the UK. Let's start with a report from the Fraser Institute. As you can see, after the 1997 ban on handguns, violent crime actually spiked in the UK. The exact opposite happened than what they intended. So let's dig a little bit deeper. What about just homicides? Well, turns out that spiked as well. And what about the Office for National Statistics in the UK? They actually have a little bit more data than the FBI, but it shows the exact same thing. So what's going on here? Surely the absence of guns is not making violence worse. Well, it turns out in the UK, they cut police funding just like they did in Canada. And the homicide rate only started to come back down once they restored the law enforcement budget. So let's recap some of the questions we answered. Does Canada have a handgun problem? No, not really. When you compare it to other countries, Canada ranks 85th in the world, which is almost exactly in the middle. It doesn't even have a gun problem when you compare it to itself. Gun violence makes up only 3% of all violent crimes in Canada. So who's doing the violence? It appears that the rural north are the areas where gun violence is growing the fastest. It doesn't appear to be gang violence or incels like the media portray. What causes gun violence? It's unclear if there's just one cause. But law enforcement budgets did decrease and immigration increased during the same period that gun violence increased. The gun laws didn't change, though. Which does show that gun laws are not the reason for the increase in gun violence. Will stricter laws decrease gun violence? The example that we reviewed suggests no. I say this in almost every video now. Politicians need to understand the economic and social impact of the policies they create. It appears that Justin Trudeau has not looked at any of the data. Like I said at the start of this episode, Canada tends to be ahead of the US in social progressiveness. Canada and the UK should serve as a study for the US in gun control legislature, indicating what to do and what not to do. Think about that.